deadly battle has taken place off the coast of Gaza as Israeli forces stormed at least one ship attempting to break the blockade of Gaza.
We cannot continue to witness these massacres carried out by inhuman occupying powers.
Barbaric act.
Once again, Israel has committed a massacre, a new massacre.
I now give the floor to the representative of United Nations Watch.
This debate turns on one question. Was this flotilla humanitarian or not? Israel, which in the past year has delivered 1 million tons of aid to Gaza, offered to receive the flotilla's cargo in the nearby port of Ashdod and, after inspection, to deliver it to Gaza. The organizers, however, rejected this offer. One supporter declared that the aim of the flotilla was either one of two good things, quote, achieving martyrdom or reaching Gaza. Mr. President, is this a humanitarian state of mind? This operation was organized by a radical group, the IHH, with extensive documented ties to terrorist groups. Their objective and means had nothing to do with humanitarianism.
The boarding of the flotilla was unlawful.
Israeli forces used unacceptable barbaric actions.
Not only disproportionate, but it concluded criminal, barbaric and brutal actions.
I give the floor to the representative of United Nations Watch.
One report showed that 7 of the 9 passengers killed had declared they wanted to die as shaheeds. How is it then that the words martyr and shaheed feature nowhere in the report?
With respect to UN Watch, to the mere fact that somebody wants to be a shaheed, and that is a term which is new to me, because where I come from, we don't know this term. But the mere fact that somebody wanted to be a shaheed was not an excuse for making them realize their ambition, so to be.
The remarks made by the representative of UN Watch betrays, I'm afraid to say, a fundamental and undenying ignorance of the law. Even if bin Laden himself was on board the Mavi Marmara, it wouldn't have made the blockade legal.
I'm now joined by Hillel Noor, the executive director of the UN Watch.
Well, look, this report was determined in advance. The Human Rights Council held an emergency session only a day or two after the flotilla incident happened. They declared Israel guilty of, quote, an outrageous attack. So the outcome was entirely predetermined. And this is not something that's exceptional. In fact, Mary Robertson, who was the UN rights chief, said that the Human Rights Council has a pattern of acting politically and not for human rights. Let's remember who the membership is. Saudi Arabia, China, Colonel Gaddafi of Libya is now a member of the Human Rights Council. This is not a body that cares about human rights. This is a body that is political, that is engaged in a constant campaign to delegitimize Israel. And I think
well,
that's
Mr. Noor,
you
know, nine people were killed.
Selective and politicized.
Okay, 9 people were killed involving the nationals from Turkey. Why are you saying that this investigation was predetermined?
Because the Human Rights Council decided before the investigation was even set up, before the members were set up, that Israel was guilty. Who can think of a legal process where before the judge is even selected, the body that establishes the inquiry declares that one side is guilty? Now, evidence was disregarded. Our organization, UN Watch, submitted evidence regarding the jihadist statements by a number of the IHH militants, some of whom had terrorist records, including hijacking a ferry in the 1990s to support Chechen terrorists. All of this evidence was disregarded.
The focus on Gaza is justified by the extremity of the occupation policies being pursued by Israel.
The Israeli disregard of civilian innocence in a wartime setting and its reliance on grossly disproportionate and excessive uses of force.
Why does your report mention nowhere that Hamas is a fundamentalist group that systematically discriminates against women, crushes religious minorities, executes political opponents, and persecutes gays? Why no mention of the Hamas Charter, which explicitly calls for the murder of Jews? Why do you disregard these gross violations of human rights? Your report makes a dismissive reference to terrorism. Given your attitude toward Hamas, given that you published a 2008 article signed in your UN capacity alleging complicity of the U.S. government in the 9/11 terrorist attacks, and given that you played a key role in publishing David Ray Griffin's book, The New Pearl Harbor, the leading conspiracy tract arguing that 9/11 was an inside job and your name is on the front cover, are you concerned about how your actions impact on the credibility of the United Nations in combating terrorism and in protecting human rights?
A special rapporteur suggested that there was an apparent cover-up in the 2001 terrorist attacks on the United States. I want to tell you clearly and directly, I condemn this sort of inflammatory rhetoric. It is preposterous, an affront to the memory of more than 3,000 people who died in that tragic terrorist attack.
Proceedings in Israel are marred by a fundamental lack of transparency. Generally, the Palestinians feel that they have not been included in a joint effort to establish the truth.
UN Watch has published a report today that documents numerous examples of your use of inflammatory language and one-sided conclusions against Israel. We note three. In 2002 and again in 2007, you cited Israel as your prime example of, quote, state terrorism. In 2006, when a German academic journal featured two opposing views on the Israeli-Hezbollah war, you presented the side opposed to Israel. Third, this past year, you accused Israel of bombing, quote, entire families on frivolous grounds. Professor Tomushat, we do not agree that these statements breach the Chatham House standard on perceived bias and the standard of your own report.
Let me just reply on a personal note to Human Rights Watch by saying that I do believe
UN Watch, yes.
I do apologize. By saying that I do believe in judicial settlement of international disputes. It seems that UN Watch does not share that view.
This morning, one of the NGOs challenged you personally, Dr. Tomochak, on your own record on Israel. Your response was not clear to those listening.
Yes. We received an email yesterday saying that...
From whom?
From a UN watch.
Right, okay. Mm-hmm.
Saying that the United Nations in Geneva still has a council, is serving Najat al-Ajai, a long-time mouthpiece of Colonel Muammar Gaddafi, from her post as a council investigator on human rights violation by mercenaries. Means in a position to advise the UN on how mercenaries... Mm-hmm. commit crimes, there is somebody that he sent there by Colonel Gaddafi. Now, when I received this yesterday, I thought like it was kind of a joke or something. But does the Secretary General knows about it? Does he have a comment about it?
As you know, the special rapporteurs are appointed by the Human Rights Council. And we would need to check with our colleagues in Geneva on this story.
forze anti-Libia più attive sembrano essere le tante organizzazioni non governative presenti a Ginevra, come UN Watch. Leon Saltiel ci spiega che questa cartella e i libri al suo interno sono stati regalati dalla Libia a tutti i membri del Consiglio dei diritti umani. Si tratta, secondo lui, di testi di pura propaganda e di bugie sulla situazione dei diritti umani in Libia. E così UN Watch ha raccolto 70 firme di altre tante ONG per chiedere l'esclusione della Libia dal Consiglio stesso. La recente elezione della Libia nel Consiglio dei diritti umani è un insulto a questi diritti e alle vittime del mondo intero.
This is CNN.
Hello, let's start with the basics. What is the Council meant to do? What is its role?
The Council is the chief United Nations body charged with protecting and promoting human rights. It's really supposed to help victims around the world.
And how does it do that?
Well, unfortunately, mostly it doesn't. If we look at the membership, it includes not only Libya, which has been suspended yesterday, but countries like Cuba, China, Saudi Arabia, Russia, Bangladesh, the countries that are not free or democratic. And so the result often is a body that is selective, politicized, and turns a blind eye to some of the worst violations around the world. Indeed, most of the violations around the world are never addressed by the UN Human Rights Council.
And many of the violations are coming from member countries by the sound of it as well. What does that say about the UN?
Well, it's unfortunate. You know, the UN was founded with noble ideals based on human rights and achieving peace and security for the world. But tragically, things have become terribly politicized.
Marie Herzog, bonsoir.
Bonsoir.
Ces gens ont cautionné des crimes atroces. Alors il y a ceux qui sont connus. Vous, votre organisation avait amené à Genève les infirmières bulgares, l'infirmier, le médecin palestinien torturé. Mais il y a beaucoup d'autres cas que vous avez constatés aussi graves.
Oui, tout à fait. Lors de la session du mois de septembre, nous avons notamment amené M. Mohamed El-Jarmi, dont le frère était un opposant au régime très connu en Libye. Il s'est fait arrêter par le régime de Kadhafi, mis en prison, torturé à mort. Pour tous ces dissidents libyens, nous avons aussi amené des victimes de Lockerbie, de la famille des victimes de Lockerbie, témoigner sur les exactions au niveau des droits de l'homme de la Libye.
The UN General Assembly is meeting to debate the issue. Joining us now from Tel Aviv is Hillel Noyer, the executive director at UN Watch, a human rights organization based in Geneva.
Let's recall that at the United Nations, not only was Libya elected to the Human Rights Council, but sitting on its advisory committee is a man named Jean Ziegler, a Swiss politician who created the Muammar Gaddafi Human Rights Prize in 1989, which has been given to Fidel Castro, Hugo Chavez, a Holocaust denier, Roger Garaudy, and recently to Erdogan, the Prime Minister of Turkey. So the United Nations also chose Libya to head its World Conference on Racism from 2007 to 2009, the Durban Review Conference. So time and again, the United Nations has rewarded this murderous, racist regime. It's a regime that has systematically persecuted over a million black Africans in that country. They're now being used cynically as mercenaries. So all of this has been known, and that the United Nations has not only turned a blind eye to these abuses, but has rewarded this regime. Libya was also the president of the General Assembly only a year ago. Libya, a couple years ago, was sitting on the Security Council. Every door that the United Nations has was open to Libya.